Hello, and welcome back to the Alphabet of Astronomy. Today is brought to you by the letter W, and W is for WIMPs. And no, this isn't an insult. I would never do that. WIMPs are weakly interacting massive particles. And yes, this does imply the existence of strongly interacting massive particles, aka SIMPs, but we're not going to talk about that today. Now, WIMPs are not a specific particle, but rather they're a proposed class of particles. And the reason that this is interesting for astrophysics and not just particle physics is that WIMPs are considered a prime candidate for dark matter. Specifically, cold dark matter, which is what we use in our most common cosmological model called Lambda CDM. Now, hot and cold dark matter doesn't refer to the temperature of the particles, it actually just refers to their typical speed. So hot dark matter generally moves at relativistic speeds, while cold dark matter is slow compared to the speed of light. So WIMPs are a type of cold dark matter. Now, to the best of our knowledge, there are four fundamental forces in the universe: gravity, the weak nuclear force, the strong nuclear force, and electromagnetism. Now, three of these forces are explained via what we call the Standard Model. So of these four forces, WIMPs interact via gravity, which we know they must because dark matter we know exists because of gravity, and via the weak nuclear force, hence the weakly interacting part of the name. Now, it's possible that WIMPs could interact via a force that's unknown to the Standard Model, as long as that force is as weak or weaker than the weak nuclear force. So the other part of the name, the massive part, indicates that these particles have a relatively large mass. So WIMPs are actually predicted to have a mass somewhere in the 1 to 100 giga electron volt range. Now, you may note that an electron volt is a unit of energy, not mass, so why are we using it for mass? Well, this is actually very common in particle physics. Technically, the mass unit is electron volt per c squared, because of course, energy and mass are related via the very famous equation E equals mc squared. Protons, for example, have a mass of about 1 giga electron volt, which is about 1.7 times 10 to the minus 27th kilograms, so you can see why this is just an easier unit to use. So I mentioned the Standard Model. Now, this is basically our current understanding of all the known fundamental particles in the universe. However, none of the particles in our Standard Model fit the bill to be WIMPs. For example, neutrinos are weakly interacting, but they're not very massive. And protons are pretty massive, but they're charged particles, so they do interact via the electromagnetic force. So if WIMPs exist, we have to look beyond the current Standard Model. Now, many extensions to the Standard Model have been proposed, and a lot of them are based on a concept called supersymmetry. And in supersymmetry, basically, the equations that govern forces and the equation that govern matter are the same. They're symmetric. And many of these extensions predict particles that would be consistent with what we consider to be a WIMP. For example, a neutralino. So great, we have theoretically predicted extensions to the Standard Model that predict particles like WIMPs, and WIMPs would explain the observations that we have made of dark matter. And so this is kind of the perfect joining of particle physics and astrophysics. And you know, this can be called the WIMP miracle, right? This is a great solution to the problem. Well, maybe not. And this is because WIMPs have never been detected, and this is not for lack of trying. So one way to try and detect WIMPs is via what's called direct detection. So this is basically, just like the name suggests, directly measuring a WIMP. There are a ton of experiments, this is just a few, that have tried to directly detect WIMPs. The challenge is that because WIMPs are weakly interacting, they don't really interact with detectors, and so this is very difficult to do. Most of these direct detection attempts rely on a really large volume in which to detect something to kind of increase the chances of one of these very rare interactions happening, and you really need to shield from background as much as possible, so they're going to be located like deep underground in mine shafts or underneath huge sheets of ice to try and block out all other signals. But so far, nothing. Now, this isn't a total loss because detecting nothing actually gives us information about what WIMPs can't be like. And there are two main properties of the WIMP that can be constrained via this lack of detection. So one is the mass. Like we talked about, this is generally going to be in the giga electron volt range. And the other is something called the cross section. Now, cross section usually implies area, and in fact, cross sections are measured in area. The units you might see are centimeters squared, or something called barns, which is just a very, very small amount of area. But in fact, in this case, the cross section is not a physical area. You're not really describing like the physical size of the particle. It's more like the probability of an interaction happening. And so particles have different cross-sections for different interactions. You can kind of think of it as the size of a target. So a larger target means something is more likely to be hit, whereas a smaller target is less likely to be hit. So that's kind of what cross-section it's measuring via this area. So this is a summary of WIMP constraints from direct detection experiments from a review that was published in 2019. And you can see these experiments are really probing quite deep into the allowable parameter space for WIMPs and saying, if WIMPs were like this, we would have detected them. So WIMPs could only exist in this kind of white parameter space that hasn't really been probed by these direct detection experiments yet. Of course, direct detection experiments are going to continue, and the detectors are going to keep getting better, the instruments are going to keep getting better, the science is going to keep getting better, and hopefully we will either finally detect a WIMP or we can finally rule them out. But for now, not yet. Now, because direct detection is so difficult, it makes sense to look for indirect detection methods that might allow you to infer the existence of WIMPs without directly interacting with a WIMP, which after all do not interact very often. So typically this is looking at astrophysical sources and looking for more easily observable particles like gamma rays that are associated with the decay of WIMPs or the annihilation of WIMPs. So they're produced from WIMPs, but they are not directly WIMPs themselves. The best place to look for such a signal is somewhere that we expect there to be a lot of WIMPs. So this is going to be things like the center of galaxies or the small dwarf galaxies around the Milky Way that are dominated by dark matter. So of course astronomers have been avidly searching for these indirect detection signs of WIMPs, and so far they haven't found any. But again, this lack of a positive result can allow us to place constraints on the properties of WIMPs. So this is an example of some constraints on WIMPs based on the non-indirect detection from the Fermi Large Area Telescope. And lastly, when nature doesn't want to play nice and send us either direct WIMPs that we can detect or indirect gamma rays or whatever from WIMPs that we can detect, we can always just try and make our own. And yes, of course, I'm talking about particle colliders. So some of these WIMPs might be produced in the very high energy collisions in a large particle collider. So for example, the Large Hadron Collider, the LHC, has been looking for WIMPs for years. Now, because WIMPs are so weakly interacting, the colliders aren't attempting to directly measure a WIMP because they're just not going to interact with the detectors most likely. So what they're looking for is usually missing momentum in all of the rest of the products of the collision that they do detect, because WIMPs, being massive, can carry away momentum. And so if there's that missing momentum, that can point the clue to WIMPs. Or again, you could have particles like gamma rays that are produced from the decay of WIMPs that then they might be able to detect, and again, point back to the existence of WIMPs. However, if you're sensing a common theme here, no, they have not found WIMPs yet with the LHC. So again, this lack of detection can tell us something about WIMPs and what they can't be like. So for example, this is from CERN and the ATLAS collaboration, basically using the decay of the Higgs boson to place limits on the properties of WIMPs. That's these blue and red lines here. They're showing some of the other constraints from some of the other things that we've mentioned. So WIMPs, or weakly interacting massive particles, have long been considered one of the most promising candidates to explain one of the biggest outstanding questions in astrophysics, which is, what the heck is this stuff that makes up the majority of the matter in the universe? Like seriously, dark matter is like more than 5 times more common than regular matter, and we don't know what it is. Maybe it's WIMPs. However, despite a significant amount of effort, we have not been able to detect WIMPs in any of the methods that we have tried. However, this lack of detection does allow us to place some constraints on the properties of WIMPs, and future detection efforts will continue to tighten those limits. And I, for one, cannot wait to see what we find or don't find in the coming decades about WIMPs. So thank you so much for watching. I hope you will join us again next time for the letter X. Have a good one. Bye.